autoridades presentes, representantes de organismos internacionales y de la sociedad civil, invitadas, invitados especiales, señoras, señores, reciban nuestro más cordial saludo. Evento 65 años promoviendo la observancia y la defensa de los derechos humanos en las Américas, organizado en conmemoración del 65 aniversario de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos. La Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, CIDH, fue creada como un órgano principal y autónomo de la Organización de los Estados Americanos, OEA, cuyo mandato surge de la Carta de la OEA y de la Convención Americana sobre Derechos Humanos. La misma fue creada durante la quinta reunión de consulta de ministros de Relaciones Exteriores, celebrada en Santiago de Chile del 12 al 18 de agosto de 1959. En este evento se reflexionará sobre el legado y los numerosos aportes de la CIDH en la defensa de los derechos humanos en la región en los 65 años que lleva promoviendo y protegiendo los derechos humanos. Damos inicio al evento con las palabras de Su Excelencia Comisionada Roberta Clare, Presidenta de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, a quien le cedo la palabra.
Thank you very much. His Excellency, Señor Rubén Ramírez Lezcano, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Paraguay, other distinguished representatives of member states of the Organization of the Americas. I also want to recognize President Nancy Hernandez López of the Inter-American Court on Human Rights. Good afternoon. Of course, the other panelists who will be speaking with us today, welcome. Distinguished members of civil society organizations, of course, the commissioners and the team from the Secretariat, and all of you supporters of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights and indeed on the Inter-American System on Human Rights. I say good afternoon to everyone. I am the chair of the commission for this year, and also, I may say, the Rapporteur for Women's Rights, as well as the Rapporteur for the Rights of LGBTI persons. And it is an honor to address you on this very special commemoration of the 65th anniversary of the Commission. And in this commemoration, I too will also be the moderator. I would like to begin by thanking our host, the Government of Paraguay, for its generous support to this event, and indeed for its support to the Commission and the Commission's work. I would also like to extend my greetings to the distinguished panelists who will be joining us this afternoon on the stage to share their perspectives on the Commission's work over the last 65 years and to speak to its legacy, to its continuing relevance, and to its promise in the observation and defense of human rights in the Americas and the Caribbean. During its 6.5 decades of existence, the Commission has evolved as a legal system of regional scope that protects the human rights of individuals, of communities, and peoples of the Americas and the Caribbean through a constant and evolving catalog of mechanisms and instruments, some of which you know very well here. But it is important to stress that the creation of the Commission in 1959 was not an isolated event, but a part of a process of hemispheric integration, which accelerated after World War II in response to the atrocities committed in that period. For 2 decades, until the entry into force of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights in 1979, the Commission was the only organ of protection of within the Inter-American system. In its early years, the Commission's mandate focused on the preparation of studies and reports, the formulation of general recommendations to states, and the provision of advice as a consultative body of the OAS, with the power to visit territories of member states as well. And the Commission's first visit, I am told, was to the Dominican Republic in 1961. During the early decades, the Commission addressed the serious human rights violations that occurred in the context of dictatorships and authoritarian regimes. And to address these massive and systematic human rights violations, the Commission used all the resources at its disposal, including tools that were not explicitly provided for in its rules and regulations. In this way, the commission began to request information from the states, which became part of the processing of individual petitions used and also used as inputs for reports on the human rights situation in the region. The commission also began to hold sessions away from its headquarters, which allowed it to respond to serious human rights situations in the hemisphere and to improve its monitoring portfolio. On-site visits continue to be one of the Commission's main tools in the face of massive and systematic human rights violations in the 1970s and the 1980s. Through its presence in the field, the Commission became an early warning voice to the international community, and it did so with profound impact. So here are some examples we consider from the Commission of outstanding examples of impact. In 1978, the OAS General Assembly requested the Commission to visit Nicaragua to gather testimony on the human rights situation in that country. The report of that visit contributed to the loss of international support for the Somoza dictatorship, and that regime left only days after the presentation of the Commission's report. The Commission returned to that country 40 years later in the context of human rights crisis that occurred within the context of the social protests of 2018. Since its expulsion and until today, it has continued to denounce the international community the serious human rights violations under the government of Daniel Ortega. Another emblematic example, I think, of relevance and impact was the Commission's on-site visit to Argentina in 1979. And a lot has been said about this in various meetings and fora over the last year. During that visit, the Commission visited clandestine detention centers and met with dozens of detainees. And this allowed the Commission to both capture and report to the international community on the human rights violations occurring in that country, particularly enforced disappearances. It would not be, I think, an understatement to say that this visit, the report of that visit, saved many lives, particularly for those who were clandestinely detained and were in danger of being forcibly disappeared. And it also marked the beginning of the end of that dictatorship. In 1998, through the on-site visit to Peru, and in its subsequent report, the Commission emphatically denounced human rights violations during the Fujimori government. The visit and the report, which brought to light very serious cases of human rights in the country, played a role in the international pressure for change of regime. Over time, the Commission's monitoring of the human rights situation has expanded to cover 35 countries in the Americas and the Caribbean. This monitoring is deployed through multiple instruments, including the activities of the rapporteurships, and you would know. No, we have country rapporteurs within the Commission, but we also have thematic rapporteurs, and we have special rapporteurs on freedom of expression as well as on economic, social, cultural, and environmental rights. We've also are able to document the situation in the region through the production of thematic and country reports, the production of the annual report, which is a very, you know, exhaustive, comprehensive review, not only of the Commission's work, but of the human rights situation in every country in the region. And the Commission holds public hearings and also publishes press releases and statements on social media, commenting on achievements as well as on violations in connection to human rights. In our concern to improve efficiency and effectiveness, the Commission has developed and is implementing strategies to respond to human rights crises in the situation. And I want to highlight the international groups of independent experts, which we fondly call GIA, for those of you who have heard that acronym and wonder what does it mean, what does GIA mean? Independent groups of independent experts. And these groups have contributed to documenting and seeking justice in serious situations, such as the human rights crises in the context of social protests in recent years in several countries in the region. The Commission has also strengthened its efforts to follow up on compliance with recommendations in recent years, recommendations from merit reports, but recommendations also from country reports and thematic reports. And we've done that through special mechanisms for follow-up in Nicaragua, Venezuela, Bolivia, Chile, and Colombia. The Commission has also implemented tools such as the Inter-American CIMORI, which is an online platform which documents recommendations as well as actions taken to implement the recommendations, and I really do recommend that Simori platform to you. It's a real fountain of information. I cannot overlook the central role that civil society has played in the development of the Commission, not only its monitoring work, but of course its protection work. And many I see here are from civil society organizations from the Americas and the Caribbean. I take advantage of this commemoration to acknowledge and express on behalf of the Commission, commissioners present and past, our gratitude for the fundamental contribution of inter-American civil society to our work, both in the historical context I have mentioned as well as ongoing today. This history, which I have briefly reviewed, speaks to the consolidation of the Commission's institutional and legal structure and how we have organized pillars of monitoring, petitions and cases, and technical cooperation with states. Based on these pillars, the current strategic plan, 2023 to 2027, has introduced other ways of addressing the current human rights situations and problems in the region. And I would like to highlight the efforts being made by the Commission to make progress in the prevention of crises, not just in response to crises. Once again, we thank states and the Inter-American Civil Society for their contributions to the drafting of this and finalization of the strategic plan. Today, the ideals that have inspired the creation of the Inter-American Human Rights System, the Commission and the Court remain valid. Nevertheless, there are old and continuing as well as emerging challenges to the fulfillment of the Commission's mission. And I say Commission's mission, but really it's the region's mission, which is to promote and protect human rights. Our hemisphere continues to be affected by extreme economic and social inequalities, by serious problems of access to justice, and persistent discrimination and violence against historically marginalized groups, which too is why the Commission has a range of thematic rapporteurships. Democratic institutions and the rule of law are threatened in some countries by a series of worrisome trends, and the enforcement of economic, social, cultural, and environmental rights is at the heart of the demands of the social protests that we have seen that have shaken up our societies in recent years. In our 65 years, six and a half decades of history, the Commission's work has touched the lives of thousands of people and brought about positive change in the communities throughout the Americas and the Caribbean. I want to say that the demand on the Commission remains high. Last year, we received over 1,000 requests for precautionary measures, and over 3,000 petitions were filed with the Commission. That gives you a sense of the relevance of this system to the peoples of the Americas and the Caribbean. Knowing that our work has this transformative impact motivates us every day to move forward with conviction, and also makes us renew our commitment to our mandate as we have been entrusted with this very solemn mandate that we commemorate today. So I thank you all for your attention as I did this brief tour to some of the highlights of the Commission. And without any further words from me, I would like to give the floor to the representative of our host, His Excellency Ruben Ramirez Lezcano, who's Minister of Foreign Affairs of Paraguay, for his introductory remarks. And once again, Minister, I really, on behalf of the Commission, thank you very much for the hosting of this event and for accommodating us. Thank you.
Yamoye Purugoko Atu, Omoahenyan de Bepeiseñe, Ekuñakarai Wasu, Roberta Claire, Jaejina, Omotenonde, Comisión Interamericana de Derecho Humano Rejewa. Fueron las palabras de Su Excelencia, comisionada Roberta Clerc, presidenta de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos. A continuación, las palabras de Su Excelencia, embajador Rubén Ramírez Lezcano, ministro de Relaciones Exteriores de la República del Paraguay.
Muy buenas tardes, distinguida presidenta de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, Roberta Clerc. Apreciados representantes de los Estados miembros y organismos internacionales, apreciados representantes de la sociedad civil, señores miembros de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, señoras y señores, le doy la más cordial bienvenida a la República del Paraguay. Es muy grato celebrar esta Asamblea General conmemorando nada más y nada menos que el 65 aniversario de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, institución de gran relevancia que ha contribuido significativamente a la promoción y defensa de los derechos humanos en la región. Desde su creación en la quinta reunión de consulta de ministros de Relaciones Exteriores celebrada en Santiago de Chile en 1959, la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos ha sido uno de los pilares de la OEA para la defensa de los derechos humanos en todos los estados de las Américas. Igualmente, ha contribuido a interpretar el anhelo general de los pueblos americanos de vivir en paz, al amparo de las instituciones democráticas ajenas a todas las influencias de carácter totalitario. Señoras y señores, el Paraguay sostiene como un principio de su política exterior la protección internacional de los derechos humanos y admite, al igual que otros estados, el orden jurídico supranacional que garantice la vigencia de estos derechos. Igualmente, creo oportuno mencionar que en el marco de los procesos en trámite ante la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, el Estado paraguayo ha impulsado y promueve las soluciones amistosas como una muestra de su voluntad en alcanzar acuerdos con las partes afectadas. De igual manera, a nivel nacional y en el ámbito de la cooperación internacional, el Paraguay aporta a través del sistema de monitoreo de recomendaciones CIMORE una herramienta para sistematizar el seguimiento de acciones vinculadas al cumplimiento de las recomendaciones en materia de derechos humanos e igualmente facilita el diseño de políticas públicas. El CIMORE refleja el compromiso del Paraguay con la rendición de cuentas, con la transparencia, con la participación y el acceso a la información. Asimismo, quiero dar un reconocimiento especial a nuestros connacionales que han aportado las labores de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, como el excomisionado y presidente de la CIDH, Evelio Fernández Arévalo, y la excomisionada Rosa María Ortiz, y de la misma manera, deseo recordar a Mario López Garelli, quien además de haber sido una extraordinaria persona, un excelente profesional al servicio de la CIDH, ha sido un enorme aporte para los derechos humanos en el continente y en la República del Paraguay. Nuestro país se compromete a seguir contribuyendo con el sistema interamericano y universal con la participación de paraguayos en sus mecanismos. Este año, el actual presidente del Comité de Derechos Humanos de la ONU, la doctora Tania Abdo, fue reelecta por un periodo más para dicha posición. Asimismo, el Paraguay postula al doctor Diego Moreno Rodríguez Alcalá para la posición de juez de la Corte Interamericana de Derechos Humanos. Señoras y señores, los aliento a que renovemos el compromiso con la promoción y con la protección de los derechos humanos en nuestro hemisferio y a seguir fortaleciendo el sistema interamericano de derechos humanos para que presentes y futuras generaciones puedan vivir en sociedades más justas y respetuosas de la dignidad humana. Muchas gracias.
Ya gente mía, ve y peisha caraiguazú, motenondeva, tetangüerandi, yocuputirá, motenondeja, tetaparaguaype, Rubén Ramírez Lezcano ñe. Fueron las palabras de su excelencia, embajador Rubén Ramírez Lezcano, ministro de Relaciones Exteriores de la República del Paraguay. Y así culmina el segmento de apertura del evento denominado 65 años, promoviendo la observancia y la defensa de los derechos humanos en las Américas, organizado en conmemoración del 65 aniversario de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos. A continuación, se desarrollarán los paneles bajo la moderación de la presidenta de la CIDH, comisionada Roberta Clare.
Thank you very much, and now it is my pleasure to invite onto the stage former commissioners of the Inter-American Commission of Human Rights, Madame Margaret May McCauley, and Madame Rosa Maria Ortiz. So we have about 8 or 9 speakers this afternoon, and the speakers will come up in tranches onto the stage, if I can put it that way. But we start off with former commissioners, and you sit where you want, Margaret. And so I would like now to start with former Commissioner Rosa Maria Ortiz, who will address, don't get too comfortable, Rosa Maria, who will address the main contributions of the Commission to the protection of human rights of children and adolescents in this region.
Muy buenas tardes. Un gusto estar aquí y recordar a la Comisión Interamericana después de muchos años. Es un orgullo este diálogo con ustedes y esta búsqueda de soluciones. Ay, perdón, me olvidé mi... Ya no estoy acostumbrada. Entonces, las gracias y comienzo como relatora de derechos del niño que fui en la Comisión Interamericana, recordando con inmenso cariño a todos mis colegas, entre ellas a Margaret. Decir que con esta imagen solo quiero que ustedes se pongan en la piel de los derechos de los niños y niñas en nuestras Américas. Cuando queremos poner a los niños en el centro, es algo que hemos aprendido con la Convención de Derechos del Niño, que fue adoptada también por el sistema interamericano y que nos enseña a que de la Constitución Nacional, la Convención y las leyes, los niños sean el centro de la atención. No quiere decir que antes no se han tratado a los niños como sujetos de derechos, y hay sentencias de la Corte que así lo indican. Sin embargo, con la aprobación de la Convención de Derechos del Niño, como convención que hasta hoy día es la más ratificada por los países del mundo, entonces vemos que ha hecho un impacto muy grande en nuestros países, porque nos ha obligado a poner a los niños en el centro. Es cierto que hoy día hay muchas discusiones, no te metas con mis niños, pero todas esas discusiones nos tienen que servir para justamente mejorar la forma de trabajar. ¿Qué es lo que nos está faltando? Que existen esas discusiones todavía, a 35 años de la Convención de Derechos del Niño. Cuando nuestra Corte Interamericana ha reconocido a través de su jurisprudencia que la Convención forma parte de un muy comprensivo corpus juris internacional de protección de los niños que debe servir a esta Corte para fijar el contenido y los alcances de la disposición general definida en el artículo 19 de la Convención Americana, que dice que la familia, la sociedad y el Estado son responsables de garantizar los derechos de los niños y niñas. Entonces, esta conversación con ustedes, que solo tengo 10 minutos, ojalá me permita recordar algunos puntos esenciales que nos ayuden a aprender a hacer el diálogo que necesitamos hoy día. Porque es como en un péndulo estamos a veces retrocediendo y sabemos que en derechos humanos no se puede retroceder. Entonces, ¿qué nos falta hacer? Todo lo que ya hemos logrado, pero ¿qué más nos falta lograr para enfrentar esa situación, para escuchar lo que necesitamos escuchar y para que aprender a hablar de manera que nos comprendan, si es que no nos están comprendiendo. Entonces, recordar un momento que esta Convención de Derechos del Niño rápidamente, 4 principios, un principio que no fue inventado por los estados en ese momento, el interés superior del niño es un principio de derechos humanos anterior a la Convención. ¿Quién duda? Hasta los animales cuidan primero a sus crías, ¿no? El interés de los niños está por encima de cualquier otro interés. El desafío es cómo aplicarlo. El otro principio de no discriminación, ¿quién duda que todos los niños, con todas sus diferencias, son niños sujetos de derechos, niñas sujetos de derechos? El derecho al desarrollo integral. No se puede decir, bueno, para que esta niña pueda estudiar, voy a separarla de su familia, transportarla a 150 kilómetros para que pueda adquirir y tener el derecho a salud o a educación. Perder el derecho a vivir en su familia y en su cultura. Son principios que nos ayudan a cambiar lo que veníamos haciendo antes de la Convención. Y nuestras leyes lo permitían. El derecho a ser oído y que su opinión se tenga en cuenta no significa, ahora tengo que hacer todo lo que dicen mis niños. ¿Quién dijo eso? Derecho a ser oído y a tener en cuenta lo que dice, para saber si te entendió bien lo que le quisiste decir. Si no le dejas hablar, ¿cómo vas a saber si te entendió? Entonces, son cosas lógicas que si se trabaja y se debate, se comprenden. Pero a veces, al decirlo así, de arriba para abajo, se malinterpreta o se usa malinterpretándolos. Con eso de con tus hijos no te metas. Cuando que dentro de la propia familia está la principal violencia contra los niños. Y eso en todos los países. Cuando que la violencia del crimen organizado está ahí porque nosotros estamos fallando en otros aspectos. Si estuviéramos ocupándonos de los y las adolescentes, no serían las primeras víctimas del crimen organizado. Están con el crimen organizado porque quieren conocer el mundo y quieren tener lindos zapatos y linda ropa, y son víctimas de trata y de violencia y se meten en las drogas porque nosotros estamos fallando. Entonces, es una invitación la Convención de Derechos del Niño, no solamente para los estados en adecuar su legislación, en adecuar sus instituciones. Yo estoy muy orgullosa en varios países, entre ellos el mío de Paraguay, como a pesar de haber vivido 35 años de dictadura, a pesar de que yo tenía 7 años cuando se creó la comisión en el 59, ahora a los 65 años, ver cómo Paraguay pudo crear un sistema de protección integral de los derechos de los niños y adolescentes. Romper lo que antes había solo una Dirección General de Menores. Ahora hay en todos los municipios y hay consejos municipales evaluando la situación de los derechos del niño en toda esta integralidad de derechos. La municipalidad con su Consejería de Derechos del Niño, que a veces malinterpreta y se le da funciones que corresponden al Poder Judicial y no al municipio. Entonces, hay que trabajar para que no se confundan los roles. la municipalidad está para que la comunidad comprenda los derechos, se organice para protegerlos, pero sobre todo que conozca los derechos. No basta tener leyes e instituciones y políticas si la propia población no las entiende o las entiende mal. O sectores interesados contribuyen para que se malinterpreten. Porque a veces ocurre así. Por las grandes empresas, que por ejemplo agroganaderas inmensas, se hacen rutas, la Transchaco, en mi país, fantástico. Pero ¿por qué, como en otros países, no se acompañan con programas sociales para que no sea solo un tema de que beneficie a las grandes empresas, sino también a la población? Y que no se confunda los derechos en relación al medio ambiente como algo que no se puede hablar, como algo que las ONGs lucran con esas cosas. Cuando que sin las ONGs no se hubiera podido hacer todo este proceso. Entonces, por eso digo que tenemos que reconocer los logros y tenemos que reconocer lo que nos falta. ¿Qué todavía no hicimos bien? ¿Qué nos falta aprender? Y una cosa que a mí mis hijos me enseñaron es no tener miedo al caos, me decía mi hija. El caos alimenta el orden. Si el orden no está impactado por ningún caos, no pasa nada, se queda estático. Entonces, tratemos de entender ese caos y tratemos de incidir para que lo que necesitamos para tener a los niños y niñas en el centro de nuestra actuación realmente sea comprendido por todos y no mal utilizado. Tenemos aquí ejemplos de cómo la Comisión de Derechos Humanos... ¿Ya son 10 minutos? ¿Ya? Bueno, rápidamente. Ejemplos de cómo el derecho del niño a la familia. ¿Quién dice que los derechos del niño están contra la familia? Poniendo fin a la institucionalización de niños en las Américas. ¿Y quiénes están peleando para construir cada vez más grandes instituciones y tener ahí a niños en lugar de fomentar que estén en familias? Que no digan que es por culpa de los derechos del niño. La Convención hizo este informe maravilloso, es un manual para todos los estados que quieran crear su sistema de protección integral de derechos del niño, aquí está. Y si no hacemos bien nuestras tareas, aquí está, violencia, niñez y crimen organizado. Son materiales que no los inventó la Convención ni la Relatoría. Todos se hacen en base a consultas con estados y sociedad civil. Lo que nos falta es conocer y hacer conocer. Voy a ir concluyendo, a pesar de que me encantaría seguir, pero decir también gracias a la Corte Interamericana, porque la Corte, a través de casos específicos, también nos ayudan a poner más énfasis y hacer cambios que a veces nos cuestan hacer. Muchas gracias a todos y a disposición.
Thank you very much, Rosa Maria, and also thank you for the reminder of the legacy of the production of knowledge and the dissemination of knowledge and the advancement of putting children at the very center of rights, children as the subject of rights, not just as ancillary to adults. I now would like to invite to the stage former Commissioner Margaret May McCauley, who only December 31st, 2023, left the Commission, and she will speak to us on the contributions of the Commission to in the context of the Caribbean, English-speaking Caribbean, but generally the Caribbean. She's been very much an advocate for the Commission becoming closer to and more given more technical support to states, as well as stronger cooperation with civil society organizations. Former Commissioner Margaret May McAuley, please come and share your wisdom.
This is the first time I've been on stage and have to stand on a little step as well. Good evening, everyone, first of all. Your Excellencies, ambassadors of member states, permanent representatives of the OAS as well, alternative representatives as well, commissioners, other state officials, members of civil society organizations, all technical and supporting staff of the OAS and the Commission, ladies and gentlemen here present, and those following online, a very good evening to you. I think this may be the last time I speak to the Commission, a body, the main human rights organ of the Organization of American States, which became my life, completely captured my life for 8 years. And I was told last year by ex-commissioner Orozco of Mexico and Jim Caballero that I have served the longest of anyone in the region in the juridical human rights system of the Organization of American States. And I have gray hairs to prove it. I wasn't aware of this fact, but when you add my years in the court as a judge and the commission, they are many. I'm really honored to be here to speak on this because apart from my passion for human rights, this is a subject that is very close to my heart. And to be here to speak on it at this very important celebration of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, 65th anniversary, oh, makes it so sweet. I have spoken about it a lot in the Commission. I've spoken about it a lot in the Permanent Council. I've spoken about it a lot to the states of the Caribbean. I've spoken about it a lot to the civil society of the Caribbean, who have been really quite inactive in the system. And so now I have all of you here. And for 9 minutes, you are in my power. So, what was the relationship between the Commission and the Caribbean? Well, when it started, there was none, because there were no CARICOM countries at that time. And the first country, Jamaica, became independent in 1962. And then it signed the charter in 1969. Then thereafter, Barbados and the other countries signed periodically as they became independent until 1991, I think was the last to sign. And then we had the total number, as we now say, of Caribbean states, which is 14. It must be pointed out that in 1959, three Caribbean states, Cuba, Haiti, and, oh gee, I've forgotten the third one. I shouldn't have drunk all that wine last night. There's a third one. I can't find it in my anyway, there was a third one, where able to sign the charter. I became members then, and there were the 21 Latin American states. So they had a relationship from the beginning. But the English-speaking countries did not. Dominican Republic was the third. Did not. And even, I have to say this, because I wrote a paper critiquing this practice. The meetings in which the resolutions came up for the membership of the English-speaking Caribbean countries were never translated into English. Can you believe it? There were English-speaking countries. OAS was talking about them coming in as member states signing the charter, but no translations came up of the proceedings in English. And this was a very bad thing, quite frankly. And it was then copied by the commission. When the commission had started having English speakers, in order for a commissioner to get a translation of the documents on which they were sitting down to work on, was those who had a loud voice and were not afraid to speak out like me would ask and say, well, I can't do anything now, and you can't deal with it because I don't have a translation. And this went on repeatedly. And it still happens today, but it is so much better, isn't it, Tanya? But there is still room for improvement. Anyway, it is so much better. So this is one way in which the Caribbean's relationship with the institution, this organ, this so important organ in the region, became better. And it is improved with the use of their language. The Caribbean NGOs were a very active group in English with the universal system, because they get their documents in English, but not with Latin, the Inter-American system, because they couldn't get translations. So they were asleep. But wait, that dragon is awake now, because we have so many things in English now. Well, not we, they. It's too soon for me to think I'm not part of it yet. And it was so good to meet all of you, all my good friends. It's like meeting family again after a good while. Nice to meet you all. Thank you. Yes. Now we have a website which is in English. Can you believe it? Now this is great steps and strides. And I think the commission ought to congratulate itself, because this is, yes, please. I thought so. These were great strides, and we have a MOOC, which is a training on the Inter-American system of human rights, this progress again, that English-speaking countries can become more invested in the system, and their peoples will have the extra and very important protection systems which the commission can give to them, because they have been very quiet in that regard. The commission has also forged relationships, entered into agreements with universities, collaborative agreements, with the Caribbean Court of Justice as well, and has had several meetings, some of which I participated in, and with the Caribbean Ombudsman Associations. So they're going from strength to strength. And one thing I kept on nagging about, there are Caribbean countries which not even one commissioner had ever visited over the years, since their membership started. So I kept on nagging about that. And last year we went to Dominica for the first time, and where else? St. Lucia. We went to Suriname, but Suriname has had visits before. Jamaica always had, Barbados had, Trinidad used to have. But the Eastern Caribbean were forgotten little islands. But there are people there whose rights are being violated. They also need the system. So the Commission is continuing to work on that. And I applaud them. And I wish them great success. We have focal persons in some of these countries. In St. Lucia, I managed to convince somebody really good to be our focal point there, to be their focal point. I must say this, that I will conclude on this very difficult point, which we've tried about, tried, and that is ratification of the Inter-American Convention on Human Rights by English-speaking Caribbean states. Only 7 have signed to date, and the rest have not as yet. So the Commission has to keep on doing what it has been doing to try and convince ratification of that. And also, there are very important conventions, which are the recent ones on racial, against racism and racial discrimination and such forms of intolerance, needs to be ratified by English-speaking Caribbean countries. Only one has ratified that. And Latin American countries, again, there are lots of ambassadors here who I used to nag. Your countries have to reach ratification as well. We must have universal ratification. And we're all getting older. We can't wait for our grandchildren to do it. We should do it in our own time. And it's about time as well. And I'm sure you will agree with me that if we have universal ratification, the Commission will be a far more effective organ for the protection and promotion of human rights in this hemisphere, which is the most interesting, but most violent, and so full of violations. So therefore, we owe it to ourselves and to future generations to move towards universal ratification and ensure that we enrich our deliberations and our analysis and decisions with the joinder of common law legal thought and civil law legal thought. Because when I joined, it was civil law, and I was happy to add my common law legal thought to the amendments we made in 2010. Was it 2010 or 2012? To the rules of procedure. I'm finished. And I thank you all for being enthralled by me. Thank you.
I'm sure you all will agree with me and thank give gratitude and thanks to former Commissioner Rosa Maria Ortiz and Commissioner Margaret May McCauley for their contributions this afternoon. Yes. Mr. Albert Randin, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Suriname. Suzanne Goldberg, Senior Advisor to the Assistant Secretary for Civilian Security, Democracy and Human Rights, United States Department of State, Mr. Marco Gonzalez, Attorney General of Paraguay, Madame Carmen Monton, Ambassador and Permanent Observer of Spain to the OAS, and Mr. Ramiro Urias from Due Process of Law Foundation. Thank you very much, panelists. And now I would like to ask our first panelist to approach the podium, and I give the floor to His Excellency, Mr. Ramdin, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Suriname, who will share his perspectives on the impact of the Commission's work in Suriname and the Caribbean countries. Minister?
Thank you. Good evening. I had no problem ceding my time to Judge McCauley, if that would help, Chairman, Chairperson. First of all, good evening. Friends, I say, because for when we speak about human rights, we all are equal. So friends all, thank you very much for being here. It's an honor and a pleasure. I want to first congratulate the Inter-American Human Rights Commission on its anniversary, 65. It's one of the oldest, if not the oldest, regional human rights organization in the world. And as such, I do believe that there is a legacy which need to be recorded, but not only recorded, must be applied as well. And as it is developing even further, it can only be to the betterment of our people. I wanted to say a couple of things because I know that we have, what, 10, 15 minutes? Okay, I'm just trying. 10 minutes. Look, the essence of any society, in my view, is to build a society which is in balance, which is providing security, which provides safety, which recognizes the need for progress. So in the political system, in the economic system, but also in the social system, you need peace and security. And that social system that is strongly affected by all what human rights institutions do. And I think it's important that we recognize that. And this is something which is one of the pillars of building a prosperous society, because that's what we need. In the end, it's not only just, I wanted to say cleaning up mess, but in fact addressing some of the key issues in our societies. It's a tool to get somewhere where life is better for everybody in society, with no discrimination. And in that context, from a government perspective, I say this: no one should feel threatened by any human rights system. No governments, no institutions, no individual. Because the idea is not to be punitive in the first place, but to be preventative in such a way that we build a better society as we go every single time. And that can only happen if we apply those standards. So I see the challenges which we face not only as a problem, but more so as an opportunity to do much better and build a stronger society. And the human rights systems and the human rights organization help facilitate that process. I already congratulated the system, and I wanted to say that in the case, because we can speak all over the Americas about this, but I believe that especially with regard to the Caribbean, where Judge McCauley already spoke about, but in the case of Suriname, we can identify concrete benefits to our society of a human rights institution. And I'll give you some examples later on in a couple of minutes. What I wanted to say is that a couple of things need to happen, I believe, in our societies in terms of building this strength of awareness about the relevance of human rights as a concept, as a mindset, as second nature. Like democracy is second nature in most countries, human rights system should be a second nature. It should be just an automatic switch in your brain that says this is what is normal. It's not the case as yet. But we need to do a couple of things for that. And I appeal to, as a next step, maybe the next 65 years, to invest in education in human rights. Schools, children, parliaments, private sector needs to be educated. That's the first one. I can't go too much deeper in it. We need to strengthen institutions that foster human rights. We all have institutions in our countries, but most of them are weak. That's a fact. The third one is we need to improve even stronger than before, not only in terms of language, but the channels of communications and the levels of communications is in communication, how to reach people to make them understand the right they have, but also the opportunities which exist there is too much of an unknown. And the last one is, I know the civil society is engaged and I'm very pleased with that, but I think another sector in which we need to engage in our societies, which is for a large part responsible for development, for prosperity, is the private sector. The private sector and human rights should be a partnership because they must work together because the one needs each other. You need prosperity, but the same prosperity needs a stable social system in society. And that is what human rights brings. So I just wanted to give that as not so much a critical note, but just say that we need to do much more. Then I think, as I don't have much time, I'm going to focus a little bit on Suriname. And by the way, for us, we are very pleased, Suriname, that for the first time, we have a Surinamese national as a member, as a commissioner on a 3-year term. Ms. Gloria De Mees, who is here, a good friend and a good scholar in law. I'm not in the position to campaign as yet for her second term, but I start doing that now, so that you know, we'll come back to you in a couple of years. But I'm very happy that we have that. This is a recognition of the relationship between the human rights institutions in the Americas, including the court and Suriname. Now, we had our visit in 2022, just after COVID-19, we had a mission from the Inter-American Court of Human Rights in Suriname. And I think one of the key things which came out of that mission is the awareness campaign which we established to establish a National Human Rights Institute, which is in progress now. It's already reached higher levels of decision making. So soon we will have a National Human Rights Institute in Suriname as the single body to direct this process. Many people have worked on this, and I'm very happy to see that we're getting closer to it. The second one is that we established a technical cooperation and mechanism between the Inter-American Human Rights Commission and Suriname. It's very useful because it led to training and also to further understanding and cooperation in terms of strengthening our human rights profile in Suriname. So thank you very much. The Secretariat of the Inter-American Human Rights Commission has been always very active and responsive to this point. So thank you very much. I always make it a point when I come to Washington, D.C., as much as I can to meet with the Secretariat, the Executive Secretariat of the Commission, because it's good to keep updated on matters. We have also, as a consequence of your visit and from the rapporteur for Suriname in 2022, that Suriname became the 11th member state and the first Caribbean country to accede to the Inter-American Convention on Protecting the Human Rights of Older Persons in May 23, the first country in the Caribbean. So we still have a long way to go. But I have listened to you. We will help promote this within the Caribbean as being part of the region itself. Let me close, Madam Chair, before signs are being provided. Two things I wanted to say at the end. One is, I fully endorse what Judge McCauley said in terms of the language, where Madam McCauley spoke about the English language and the translation issues. We still have a language which is still outstanding, and that's Dutch. We're not going to make it a big deal, but it is hampering the process of information, the speed with which you can handle things. Members of parliament do not always have the same breadth of knowledge of English, so that needs to be translated in Dutch. And so it's from Spanish to English to Dutch. Can you imagine? That's quite challenging. So this is a real issue for us as well. I think in the end we can live with English, but I think it's something which we have to keep in mind. Those two things I wanted to say. And lastly, this is not a criticism to any system, but as we do not live in isolation, I believe we live in complex realities in today's world, really complex realities. In the world, in this hemisphere, in this region, I think it's very important that the Commission takes also note of those social realities and cultural realities on the ground. It's critically important to make the right decision. And I mean this in a very positive way, and that's why I invite the Commission to come to our countries and experience themselves and speak to different stakeholders about the work that needs to be done and the perspectives that they would like to bring to the table. This is a process which is not just a laboratory. This is humans working together. So thank you very much. Appreciate very much the opportunity. There's much more to say. And subsequently, in another meeting, we'll do that as well. Thank you very much, and congratulations.